This is your Anxiety Toolkit, episode number 137. Welcome to Your Anxiety Toolkit. I'm your host, Kimberly Quinlan. This podcast is fueled by three main goals. The first goal is to provide you with some extra tools to help you manage your anxiety. Second goal, to inspire you. Anxiety doesn't get to decide how you live your life. And number three, and I leave the best for last, is to provide you with one big, fat virtual hug. Because experiencing anxiety ain't easy. If that sounds good to you, let's go. Welcome back, everybody. Oh my goodness. So thrilled to have you here with me today. I am pretty kind of inspired by this episode. I'm so excited to share this with you. And the reason I'm so, there's multiple reasons why, but the one question I have for you is there something you really want to do, but anxiety is holding you back? Is there, you know, a place you want to go, a thing you want to try? Like, where is anxiety getting in your way? If you can answer that, I think you're going to love this episode, because today we have the amazing Gilad Gamliel, and he is a blogger, and his whole mission is to help people with anxiety to manage their anxiety while they travel and to be inspired to travel. Even though you have anxiety, you're just going to bring it along with you. And he tells this beautiful story. Actually, he tells many, many awesome stories about how he did that and the many, many countries that he has visited and the many, many scenarios he had to go through to and manage his anxiety along the way. So I'm so, so excited and so grateful to Gilad for coming on the show and sharing all of his brilliance with us. Before we get over to that interview, let me just go through a couple of really important things. Okay. Number one, we have OCD game changers coming up really soon. I know I've mentioned it for the last few episodes, but we're getting really, really close. So if you're interested and you're in the Denver area in March, the first week of March, do go on to OCDgamechangers.com, buy yourself a ticket, and I'll meet you there. All right. The second humongous piece of information. It's sort of like so excited. I could just like jump up and down. ERP school is back, folks, and I'm so excited to share it with you. So yeah, we offer it twice a year, once in September and once in February. And starting on February 27th, ERP school will be available again. And the reason I'm so excited about this episode is because it is the greatest inspirer to get you thinking bigger and thinking about life with anxiety instead of trying to have life without it. And I really feel that if you can answer that question, like, what do you really want to do and where is anxiety holding you back? If you've identified that, ERP school is your thing. Like, that's where you go to learn the tools so that you can move in that direction. And I'm so thrilled to share it with you. So if you're interested, you can go to cbtschool.com, click on courses, and it is called ERP School. Last but not least, the I did a hard thing for this week was given to me by a very dear friend. And I just love when friends tell me that the I did a hard thing is sort of like spreading into people's families, you know, into their homes. And she says this: my daughter, who is a cheerleader, had a nasty fall while tumbling, and ever since, she's been struggling with panic attacks when she tries to tumble. She recently started going to her tumbling class again, and it has been so hard for her. She has been really nervous to fall and nervous to have another panic attack. But last week, she did not want to go, but we talked about doing hard things and not letting fear keep us from the activities we love. And she pushed through and she went to her class. Just walking into that gym was a hard thing for her, and I am so proud of her. And I am proud of her too. What a great story. You know, this the concept of doing hard things is not just for adults, it's for kids too. It's for all of us, right? We can all learn to face fear, right? And we can all do hard things, right? Speaking of hard things, let's get through to the episode. Here I have again Gilad Gamliel. We are going to talk about traveling and the wonderful pieces of traveling and how you may bring your anxiety along with you. Have a good day and I'll see you next week. Well, welcome. I am so excited for this episode. This actually was really, I'm very, very excited to hear what we have to say and what our guest has to say. I have with us Gilad Gamliel telling us a story that I think you all really should hear. So welcome, Gilad.
Hi, how's it going?
Good, thank you. So tell us about, I thought your story was intriguing. Tell me or tell us a little bit more about your history and what your mission is right now.
Right. So I started my website, Anxious and Abroad, about a year ago, where I just sort of thought that there was something missing from the conversation about anxiety, in particular, and how it applies to travel. And I'm 27. I'm from New York. I grew up kind of knowing all about my anxiety and knowing about my OCD, and I just didn't find any resources for it. So when I was 23, I just decided to book my first international trip. I did 2 months in Southeast Asia, and ever since I've been like hooked. And I just think it's important for people to know that you may think that travel isn't for you, but it's for everybody. And I want everyone to know that there are things you can do to make travel easier when you have anxiety and when you have OCD. And there are very concrete practices and techniques that you can do to make it a bit more comfortable for you.
Right, right. So my first question is, can you tell us a little bit, if you're open to discussing, like, what was your experience with having anxiety? How did that show up in your life?
Sure. Well, I'm 27 and I've had anxiety for 27 years. I don't remember a time in my life where I wasn't anxious or nervous about something. You know, I was a very sensitive child, and it was just pointed out to me at a very young age how wound up I was. But I didn't really know about my interactions with OCD until college, when I started getting, in particular, health obsessions, sort of similar to hypochondria and stuff like that. And once I kind of had a grip on what OCD was, I knew a bit more how to handle it. Because I think the thing that I'm sure you know and all of your listeners know is that when you're learning about how to treat OCD, the thing that you have to do feels like the complete opposite from what your body wants to do.
Right.
So once I started learning about what I was doing and what I needed to do to improve, that's when the travel bug started hitting me. Because, you know, with ERP, exposure and response prevention, it's all about, you know, forcing yourself to, you know, confront the things you're afraid of rather than avoid them. And I was avoiding, you know, a lot of the world up until that point.
And so, like, I think so many people, a lot of people have told me, like, what would be your dream, you know, if you got through this? And they often do say it's to be able to travel.
Yeah. Well, a big reason why I wanted travel to be a focal point of my life is because it's something that so many people want to do. And it's so romanticized just in the media and on Instagram and everything. And I think what people who are anxious don't recognize is that everything you're seeing is so one-dimensional. And you think that all these people on Instagram and on Facebook have perfect lives and are carefree. And the truth is, they're just as complex as we all are. And I wanted to bring a voice to people like me, and I think a vast majority of people who think that it might not be for them, so they can see that the reality is that it very much is.
Okay, cool. All right, so you got the health bug. Was this when you'd started to kind of break through a lot of your anxiety, or where were you in like your recovery process?
I was really like, I mean, I want to say the tail end, but, recovery isn't tail end. I was doing, for the first time in a long time, doing very well when I got my travel bug. I was seeing a therapist. I've seen a bunch of therapists, some of which were very old school and didn't know how to treat OCD. They told me to do the rubber band snapping thing on my wrist. And when I finally saw a therapist who knew how to treat it with ERP, he was like, that's very outdated. We don't do that anymore. So once I started working with him for a while, this was probably maybe like 6 months into therapy with him, I started feeling better. And that's when I think I was riding a high from like saying yes to things and not avoiding things. And I recognized that travel was something I had wanted to do and was avoiding. So I just sort of leaned into it.
Wow. All right. So tell me about the day you booked this flight.
Okay. So I was in Houston, Texas, doing an internship at this point. It's funny, like I actually think that my internship in Texas was the first step in like getting out there with travel because I had never been away from home before. So I was in Texas and I had called up my friend Dan, who we had spoken really, really like briefly about traveling together. It was like a romanticized idea that somewhere down the line we would do it. And just one day I decided to call him and I'm like, hey, let's actually plan this. And he's like, well, I'm working, but let me think about it. And then a few days later, he called me and he's like, okay, I'm gonna quit. Let's go to Southeast Asia.
Wow.
And we started booking 2 months in Southeast Asia, five different countries. And it was incredible. We had a few friends join us for a leg of it, but for the most part, it was just me and my friend Dan.
All right. So, okay, tell us now about how you traveled. Like, how did you get through that? Tell us all that good stuff now.
It was just one of those things where, like I said, the exposure therapy was helpful in the sense that it started showing me that the things that I'm afraid of, I can push through and be okay. And once I sort of had that in the back of my mind, it was a bit of a snowball effect because I was definitely anxious about my trip leading up to it for months in advance. You know, the big what ifs from anxiety and OCD together that kind of try and keep you stuck in one place. They were very much active, but you know, I just like took it one day at a time. And once I booked stuff, I was like, okay, it's done. I spent my money. I'm not gonna back out. I have my friend to hold me to it too. And you know, between the two of that, it really just, I don't know, I just stuck with it.
So it was sort of like a radical acceptance. Once you buy that ticket, it's
Yeah.
hard to step back, right?
100%. It was one of those things. It was just like, whatever's going to happen there is going to happen. I'm going to be worried about it, but I know this is worth it. I know this is something I want to do, and I'm going to push myself.
Right. Okay. So tell us how you did it. Tell us the tools. Like, I know you have some thoughts on this. How can other people be? I mean, I think people are probably listening going, oh, that's cool for you, but. Not me. My anxiety would be too much, right? So can you share, like, can we speak to that specific person?
Totally, yeah. So the biggest reason why I made my website in general is because I kept encountering people who said the same thing to me. They would be like, you're so brave. How do you travel that long by yourself or with one other person for that long? And I'm like, no, like for the majority of my life, I felt less brave than you or anyone else in front of me. But the fact is, the reality of it is just less scary than the what ifs in your mind. And the only way to know it is to go and do it.
Right.
But on my website and in general, I have all of these ideas about how to make it easier for people who have the jitters before the trip, and then some tools to hold on to once you're actually there so that you don't, you know, fly into a panic.
Right. Would you share? Would you
Yeah,
share
of course.
the tips before you travel?
Yeah, of course. So before I travel, I think it's really important to keep your perspective in check because your anxiety is going to try and force you to think that this is going to end in catastrophe every single time. And it's going to make you think that this is permanent. So I have a few things that I always think about, which is one, this is not permanent. You have an end date and you know when you're coming home. So rather than treating this as a big, scary, intimidating thing that will never end, I think it's important to think of it as ra like a little like step outside your comfort zone rather than jumping permanently out of it.
Right.
So that's, I think, quite big. And then also just remembering that this is travel in the 21st century and that you are going to be connected to people from home. Your support system from home will exist. It'll be a bit more difficult to stay in touch with them, but they're there. You know, there's a page on my site about apps you can download for travel, and I found them so useful. I always use WhatsApp because I can always text and call on Wi-Fi. There are so many ways to stay in touch with people. So it's not so much a full-on leap outside your comfort zone. It's just a temporary step outside of it that still includes the things that you hold dear to you. And you don't have to worry about it like consuming your life.
So, I know a lot of people say to me, I know I will come home. I know I'll get through it, but how do I get through that high level of anxiety when I'm there?
So one of the biggest things that I have found helpful for me in particular is to socialize. The way I travel is always backpacking, and it always involves staying at hostels because it's just cheaper and I can't afford it the other way. And it's just, I think there's a huge misconception about hostels. I think the people who haven't been to them in recent years think that they're very dingy and old-fashioned and dangerous, but they're very nice. Like, I've stayed in some hostels that are, one private room away from being like a five-star resort. But my biggest thing is to socialize with other travelers because it is a really good way to ground yourself and get you outside of your head and into your life when you are forced to talk to people in front of you. And as somebody with social anxiety, that really scared me because I cringe at the thought of like approaching a stranger, But the socializing rules of travel are a bit different too, in the sense that no one wants to do stuff by themselves. And if people are by themselves, they want company. And you have things to talk about ahead of time because you're all in the same boat. So there are so many ways to talk to each other. And I think that socializing is the easiest way to keep your anxiety in check while you're gone.
So really what you're saying, and I know I want to hear more of what you're saying, but I think what you're saying is travel makes you do ERP. It's the whole thing is ERP. Is
Yeah,
that correct?
it's a literal geographic flight outside of your comfort zone. You can't, I mean, that, like I said, there are definitely some things that you can do to make it more comfortable, but at the end of the day, you are in another country. And you can't like run to your room, like to your comfortable little box, right? So it's a complete jump outside your comfort zone.
So I love what you said about the social. I think that that's really, I really like how you said, like, most people want company. They actually want you to approach them. What about people like the unknown, going to something that it's more about the uncertainty of where will I get milk from and all that kind of stuff?
Well, so to that I say, there's a lot of planning you can do ahead of time, not so that your trip is structured to the minute, but so that you can get acquainted with where you're going. The way I like to travel has always been book a few things, know your route, know which direction you're going, but leave a lot of room for flexibility because you're going to want it while you're there. But having said that, when you do plan ahead of time, there are things that you can do to get your brain ready for the differences while you're there, whether that's cultural norms, languages, just the way they treat different people and all kinds of, I don't know, they're just small subtleties to get used to while you're there. And if you can do the research ahead of time, and thankfully the internet has tons of it now, then you will feel a bit more comfortable once you finally are there. I always say my biggest fear on every one of my trips is landing in the airport and not knowing what to do or how to get where I'm going. So I always do the research ahead of time to know where is my hostel, where is the airport, how do I get from point A to point B. So once I'm there, I have a plan. And then once I get to my hostel, it's almost like a little bubble of like a makeshift comfort zone in an area that's unfamiliar because everybody speaks English, everybody's in the same boat. The staff is usually there to help you and has information for you. So once you do a little bit of the research, things get a lot easier. They still are uncertain, obviously, but it's a lot less of a frenzied panic when you do a little bit of research.
So I think that's cool because you're saying because there are so many uncertainties, you can find small areas of like knowledge to help you get there. And once you're there, that's when these sort of bigger exposures happen. Now, can I ask, how did your health anxiety show up in your travel?
In every way. I am constantly worried about getting food poisoning. I'm constantly worried about being far away from a hospital or a good hospital while I'm away. When I was in Guatemala one time, we were staying at this like camping hostel on the edge of a really beautiful lake. And in the bathroom, it says on the door, "Don't eat at certain restaurants here because we are 7 hours away from a hospital." And I was like, "Oh my goodness, I have to be very careful." But at the same time, once again, knowing that everybody is with me and doing the same things as me helps in the sense that you're not alone and you don't feel alone. And that goes for solo travel as well, because I don't think that solo travel means traveling by yourself. But My health anxiety shows up in a lot of ways. There was one time in, I went to the Amazon in Bolivia and I was swimming with pink river dolphins, which was really cool. But the water was brown. Like you couldn't see your hand in the water right in front of you. And I was like, this is where I get a brain-eating parasite and I will die in 5 days. But, you know, I'm not going to miss the opportunity to swim with pink river dolphins. So let's just see what happens. And I just think you would be surprised the things you can talk yourself into when you're riding the high of a trip.
Yeah. And I think I've had a couple of clients who have had very similar like themes of anxiety. And what they had to do was really keep like the dolphins, like even though anxiety is showing up, just keep reminding yourself, like, I came here to see this. Like, this is why I'm here. Like, do not let fear get in the way. So I think you did that.
It is like the end all argument for anything while you're traveling. There was one thing that I did in Vietnam. I went to on a canyoning trip, which is climbing down waterfalls, which is terrifying. And I had full intentions to not do it the entire trip until I got there. And then everybody at the hostel was like, we're all doing it. Let's just do it. You know, if we die, we die together. It's fine. But the long and short of it is like, you came here to do this. You should try it. And obviously within reason, you shouldn't do things like, you know, irresponsibly, but you know, you're on a trip to do the things that you're there to do, and you can't let anxiety dictate it. That's the reason you came here, probably.
So you're talking about some really cool stories and some amazing countries. Did this always seem to be what you wanted, or has this sort of snowballed? Was it one trip and then it became more and more?
It's so funny. After my first trip, my parents were like, okay, you're good. You got it out of your system. Let's move on. Career, let's move on. And I was like, oh, no. This was like a catalyst. I'm going to keep doing this. So in my line of work, I work in animation and things are contract based. So you finish a season of a show and then you have however much time off before the next one starts. So I try to take as much advantage as I can and, you know, plan trips around work. But it definitely has snowballed. It was a nice romantic idea before my first trip. And then once I saw the reality of it, I was just hooked.
Right. All right. So I kind of skipped there a little and I want to go back. Is there any other tools that someone can use before they take on their trip? I want to make sure I didn't cut you off there.
No, that's fine. Yeah, I think the perspective is really important, and it's really re important to remember the fleetingness of it. You know, I said it's not a full stop, like huge change. And other than that, so I said plan, I said know your time constraints. And for the most part, it's just about, you know, holding yourself to it. You know, you book your trip, you know it's something you want to do. You're not forcing yourself into something that you don't want to do. But when you book it and you like commit the money to it, all of a sudden it has a bit more gravity to it, which is a good thing because it's in my opinion, a positive sort of pressure that you put on yourself. Obviously, if you get to the day of and you're like not doing well, I need to see your therapist often, then you know there are exceptions. But for the most part, I just think it's so worth doing that that kind of pressure that you put on yourself is a little bit important in this case.
So what I think what you're saying is you kind of do have to double down,
Yes, you
right?
do. You do have to double, you just have to commit to it. And I think that comes for me from a standpoint of, you know, up until my first trip, me and my friends would always just say, oh yeah, we're gonna do something, we're gonna do something, it's gonna be great. And it never happened. And I just got tired. And I was like, you know what? I wanna do something. And if I have to go by myself, I'll go by myself. And that's just the end of it. But once you allow yourself to just sort of surrender to, you know, the pressure you put on yourself, the positive pressure you put on yourself, it just gets a lot easier to talk yourself into it because you know it's something you want to do.
Right. So while you're there, are you day by day managing intrusive thoughts?
Yes, I am every day of my life managing intrusive thoughts. But again, I only really go on these trips once I know I'm doing well in therapy and I know that I can manage it. And I do have my tools while I'm away. I really like the Headspace app and I use that often. And that's what I kind of use to ground me. And then otherwise, I, you know, make sure that I'm staying active and it's stimulated. And I think that stimulation is really important for me. And I think for a lot of people with OCD and anxiety, idleness and like routine can kind of develop into a sort of poison for the mind because it's really easy for your brain to just start ruminating on things that aren't important. And one of the reasons I like travel so much is because you're met with positive stressors and stimuli every day. Like, you have to know how to get to my hostel, how to navigate this language barrier. I want to go on a trip to a waterfall. How do I get there? How do I get back? And so your brain is really occupied. And when it's occupied, it just doesn't have the time to focus on all these other things as much. So it gets a lot easier for me to sort of like wave off the intrusive thoughts when I have so much going on than it is for me while I'm home, you know, sitting at work.
Right. I agree. I'm way more mindful when I'm traveling because I'm looking at like, oh, look at that colorful statue. And isn't that a beautiful smell? I could be doing that here in America, but I don't because I'm not quote unquote traveling, right?
Right. Because it sort of just forces you out of your head. You know, there's like that quote, I can't remember who said it, but I think actually it was someone on your podcast recently who said, get out of your head and into your life. And once I heard that, I was like, oh, this is exactly what I need to do all the time. If it's just refocusing my attention from inward to outward, it helps tremendously, pretty instantly. And when you're home, you know, because of the routine and because of the familiarity of everything, it's really easy to just ignore all the, you know, I live in New York. There's so many amazing things around me. You live in LA, it's great, but you get used to it. And when you're traveling, what I love about it is it's a constantly self-renewing resource of interesting things to see.
Right. So
you just don't have as many opportunities to get bored, and you don't have as many opportunities for your brain to get complacent. And when a brain, in my opinion, isn't complacent, there's not as much time or room for OCD to kind of sneak in.
Have you ever, in your therapy with your therapist, planned a trip as like a on-purpose exposure?
Mm-hmm. I never planned one on purpose, but I remember when I was planning my trip to Guatemala, I was getting really nervous about it because it was one of those countries I knew nothing about. And my therapist particularly said, this is a really good opportunity to practice exposure. Treat it rather as something you're dreading or need to get over with. Treat this as a positive opportunity to make the fears less intense in the future.
Right, right.
And it worked. I mean, I had a great time.
Right, right. And what was your response to that in that moment?
I think once I started learning about exposure and radical acceptance, I just sort of got on board with it to the point where I was like, okay, I get it. I know. Like, you're right. I have to do it.
Right.
Anytime my therapist now gives me homework that I don't like, he's like, how do you feel? And I'm like, I know I have to do it. I'm going to do it. I don't want to do it, but I know I have to. So thankfully, I have that kind of insight. But it's, you know this too. Your body, every fiber of your being resists these things when your OCD is screaming at you. You know, it feels completely counterintuitive. So it's really difficult. But once you do it and you start seeing the effects of it, it just becomes so, you know, freeing.
Right, right. Have you ever had a panic attack while you're traveling?
Yes, actually, I did. When I was in Peru, I actually fainted one time, which was a really big deal. I had just flown from Lima to Cusco, which is a pretty significant change in altitude. And I hadn't eaten or drank all day. And then I met some friends at the hostel and we went out that night and I had a few beers. And then we went to get pizza afterwards and I fainted in the bathroom of the pizza place. I got a huge gash on my forehead. I still have a scar from it. And I didn't have a panic attack then, strangely enough, but when I went on my trip to Guatemala, I kind of felt similar pangs of like lightheadedness or dizziness. And I was convinced that, okay, this is going to be the same thing. I'm going to faint. I can't go on my hike tomorrow. And then just, you know, the negative thoughts just swirled from there. But thankfully, the people at my hostel and the friends that I was traveling with, they're aware of my OCD and my anxiety and were able to sort of like talk me down and it was really helpful. And then I went the next day on my hike and I was totally fine.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. And that's cool though. I mean, it's cool. Yeah. And it's cool that you're so open with people about it and that they can help you.
Huge reason why I do my website to begin with is just, I think we're in a really cool time where people are starting to talk about mental health a lot. And people are starting to realize that everybody has these things to a degree. And once you, I think it was Brené Brown who said something like, shame can't exist when you bring it out into the light. And I used to feel a lot of shame about my anxiety and my OCD. And once I started talking to people about it and connecting with them and realizing that we all feel these things, it just sort of started to dissipate. And so my friends know, my family knows, I'm really open about my OCD. I'm really open about my anxiety, because I don't really think there's any shame in it. With travel in particular, you're doing something that most people are afraid to do. If you're going on a trip alone to a country you've never been to with a language you don't know, you're doing something that is inherently scary and you're pushing yourself through it. If you're scared of it, there's no shame in feeling that way because you already did something that most people are too scared to do.
Right, right. Yeah. Absolutely. And I think what I would even validate is, even if you wanted, and maybe you can speak to this, is maybe even if you started with a country that's not so much different than your country as a starting point. I mean, I remember when I came to America, I was 19, and everyone was saying, like, it's English, like they speak English. You're going to get the same food. You're probably going to get the same food products as well. But I was still freaked.
I totally understand that. Weirdly enough, my first trip was to a region of the world where they speak, every country spoke a different language that I knew none of. I don't know why that was my first choice, but definitely, I think there are ways to ease into this that are, you know, a bit easier than others. If you jump into a country where the cultures are completely different and the infrastructure is completely different and the language is completely different, it can be really overwhelming. I think that, yeah, if you speak English, English-speaking countries are a great place to start. I personally wanted to go to Australia and New Zealand for my entire life. And then there are other countries in Europe that are so heavily influenced by tourism that most, like, people will speak English. You can get around. Signs will be in English. And those are really good jumping points for people who may be too scared to, you know, go to such remote parts of the planet. But having said that, I've never been to a place before where I couldn't get around with my level of expertise, which is not a lot.
Right.
I went on my first solo trip to South America. I went to Ecuador, Bolivia, and Peru, and I knew no Spanish at all. And I don't know. I guess I was just like, I'll figure it out when I get there. And it's not that I wasn't anxious, because I definitely was, but I just knew that it would be okay from my previous trips. And by the end of my 2 months, I was speaking enough conversational Spanish to like have a chat with the cab driver who took me to the airport.
Wow. That's really cool. That's really, really cool. Is there anything that we haven't talked about that you feel like is really important for our listeners to hear?
I think it's important, and I really stress this a lot because I see the impact of it. People really need to pay attention to the effect that social media has on us. I mean, I follow a lot of travel people on social media, and I'm guilty of this too. There are so many techniques that people do to make you think that they're living their best life. And they are living at just as a complicated and stressful life as you are. They're just showing you the right moments of
it. Right,
right. And I think for me, a huge thing that kept me stuck before I started traveling is this notion that travel just wasn't for people like me. I thought it was these like free-flowing kind of hippie people who don't really have a lot of cares in the world who are doing this. And the reality is that it's just not. Like, they're struggling, you're struggling, they're filtering everything, they're cropping out garbage, they're cropping out their bad day. They're, you know, they're everyone is playing this game to top each other. And once you really pay attention to the fact that everyone's doing it, it kind of frees you from the negative self-talk that you can experience from it. I think it's really detrimental, and it makes people think that they're less than, when the reality is everybody is on the same page.
Right, right. And I really appreciate that. I wasn't expecting you to go in that direction. How did that impact you?
I think expectations are important. And I think my expectations of my first trip were a bit too high, given that I've never done it before. And I remember coming home after having a great trip and still feeling a little disappointed because everything I saw online just felt different from what I saw in person. And that's insane because I just went scuba diving. I went canyoning. I went zip lining. You know, I did all these really incredible things and I was still feeling this sort of lack. And I think when people tailor their expectations to meet something that's impossible, it really messes with you. And the reason I talk about it is because I see it with travel all the time. And I talk to people who come back from their trips feeling the same way. But it applies to everything, you know? People think that everybody's living their best life and everybody's struggling too. And once you kind of reduce your expectations, or at least temper them to the degree that you know what the reality could be like, you free yourself from disappointment from something that doesn't need to disappoint you.
Right. Do you meet, like, I know this is like you're talking about the expectations and other people. Do you meet other people who like connect with you about anxiety?
I've never met with people in person. People have reached out to me from my website through email and Instagram and stuff, and I've spoken to them a lot. Actually, the other day, someone emailed me saying that they had never traveled before, and they just started studying abroad in England, which is a huge, leap for them, and they have all these anxiety problems, and they were really concerned about it, but they looked at my site and it helped them a little bit. And what I really want people to know is that there are things you can do. And one of the things I really appreciate about this podcast is that you give really concrete, really functional advice that I think we don't see a lot of. I remember I saw an article, I don't remember where, but it was about like travel anxiety, and it was like what you can do. And it was just such like theoretical stuff. It was like change your perspective, be positive, and that kind of stuff. And while that is good advice, that's something that takes years to hone. And when you're trying to plan a trip in a month, you need something immediate. And I think the people that have reached out to me recognize that what I try to give them is kind of like cut through the nonsense, like let's give you some actual advice kind of stuff. And they seem to re it seems to resonate with them.
I love that. I think so much of what you're talking about, I know you even referenced, I think it was a quote by Stephen Hayes, "Get out of your mind and into your life." And his is all around actually putting your attention towards what do you want out of life, right? Like not what are you afraid of? Like what do you want? And I think you're speaking to that. Like you're actually talking a lot about acceptance and commitment therapy, which is
I
fully
just
engaging
listened
with
to
your values.
your interview with that. I can't remember her name, but I just listened to that interview a few days ago. I
Yeah,
really
see,
loved it. Yeah.
and you're living that already.
It's important. I mean, the reason I booked my trip at 23 is that until then, I just felt like bullied by my anxiety and by my OCD to the point where I was planning my life around it. And I was tired of it because I had bigger goals than that. And it's just, like I said, once you get the travel bug, it snowballs. And it's like that with any goal. Once you kind of push through the discomfort and you get out the other side and realize that you're okay, it is evidence for you moving forward that it worked and you didn't crumple into a pile on the floor, like you, it snowballs, it really builds on itself.
Right, there's a sense of mastery there.
Yeah,
Yeah.
really.
Well, I love what you have to say, and I'm so grateful we're talking about this because I think it's just sort of fun, you know? Like it's such a fun topic, and I really do think, actually, I'm going to ask you one more question.
Sure.
I know I've touched on this already, but I think even as we get ready to close up here, some people, particularly those with severe anxiety, are going to still say, yeah, but he's some kind of special human to be able to do that. You know what I mean? Like that takes, you're talking about commitment and a lot of willingness and living your values, and these are all great points. But what would you say to the person right now who's listening and saying, yeah, but that's those people, not me?
Well, what's funny is that I thought I was like that too. Like I told you, when I wanted to plan that trip, I didn't think it was for me. I thought it was for people who had more commitment or follow through. And I think what I would say to them is just think about what you want out of, I mean, life in general, but like, what are your goals? Like, do you want to travel? Is it really something that you can make a priority or want to make a priority? And then once you do that, find the small steps to build up to something intense like that, I guess. I understand it's scary. I know that. And I fully sympathize because I was that person before my first trip. But I just think people think that travel is scarier than it is. And that's the whole point of my site. I want you to know every single person who is worried about it, I've done it. I've worried about it. I'm alive. It's okay. I've been through the gauntlet. And that's why I made this website so that you can see that I've done it. And I started at your position and I'm here now.
And you've taken anxiety every step of the way.
Every step of the way. I have anxiety every single day of my life. It's in the back of my mind. Sometimes it takes the forefront of my mind too. But I've tried to cultivate a better relationship with it. And my therapist has been really good with that. But it's just about like getting up one day and thinking, I see you, anxiety. I just don't want you to like to run my whole life. I just don't want it.
Right. Yeah, so inspirational. Thank you so much for coming on. Tell us
Thanks
where
so much for
people,
having me.
tell us where people can find you and your resources.
Sure. So my website is called Anxious and Abroad. So it's just www.anxiousandabroad.com. It has everything you can think of. I've literally combed through absolutely every piece of travel advice and recommendation that I've ever had, and I've put it on the site. I'm in the middle right now of uploading all of my travel itineraries so that people can sort of plan around that if they wanted to. You can find me on my Facebook group, which has the same name, Anxious and Abroad, or you can follow my Instagram, which is at Gil Adventures, GIL.AD.VENTURES. I'm warning you, it is a travel, like, Instagram. It's going to look a little flowery. It's going to look a little, like, filtery, but, you know, what can you do?
Right. I love it. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. This was a lovely experience.
Great.
I really appreciate it. Take care.
Please note that this podcast or any other resources from cbtschool.com should not replace professional mental health care. If you feel you would benefit, please reach out to a provider in your area. Have a wonderful day, and thank you for supporting cbtschool.com.